So can we start? Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
Yes, sister, I put the scripture, Acts.
Start. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Abba Father. Thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you, Jesus. Yes, Lord, we stand in awe of you because you have chosen us. You sent your only Son for us to teach us the way. The only way. And today, Lord, you are teaching us much more deeper how it is that you want us to enter into your presence as priests, as a royal priesthood. Friends, I encourage you this morning to ponder through what you did yesterday. Did you go out, step out in faith as a priest? Carrying the gospel, whatever was the gospel that you have experienced, and did you share it with anybody? If no, today is a new day. His loving kindness, tender mercies are new. Let's do it today. And today, we're going to learn a very beautiful way how to enter into his presence and how to remain in his presence. Many a times we enter, but then we cannot sustain or we don't maintain for whatever reason, the distractions, the fear. Thank you, Jesus. Aaron, who was the first high priest, is a model for us as the priesthood of believers who serve God in Christ. God's commandments to Aaron help us understand our New Testament role as a royal priesthood. 1 Peter chapter 2 verse 9. We see from God's instructions to Aaron on how to enter his presence on the Day of Atonement. We may understand how to come into his presence today. And in the coming days, friends, we're going to learn of 10 different ways from the book of Leviticus, how we are going to enter and remain in the presence of God, where we can commune with him, offer effectual prayers, and meditate on the world's behalf. The very first thing we need to clear is we need to have an appropriation of God's grace in our lives. Simply saying, we need to understand God's grace. God's grace is his willingness to empower us with his ability, his authority to get God kind of results. In Leviticus 16 verse 3, it says, this is how Aaron is to enter the sanctuary area with a young bull for a sin offering and a ram for a burnt offering. Now God told Aaron to offer animal sacrifices to atone for the sins of Israel, because in the Old Testament, we know that Jesus had not yet come. But in the New Testament, we no longer offer any more animal sacrifices. Aaron could not enter the sanctuary area without the sin offering and burnt offering. For you and me today, God says to us, if you desire to enter my presence, your sin has to be dealt with first. Therefore, what is the first step in prayer? Let's pay attention to this one. It is not to present our petitions, but to examine our lives for sin. Sometimes sin are glaring. They're very visible. Everybody can see. Like something like adultery or alcoholism or any kind of addiction. But then there are subtle sins like anger, pride, jealousy, even unbelief. It's a sin. they may relate. There are different kinds of sins. They can relate to our family, our friends, the church, our workplaces, in our finances. We can be stingy. We don't like to share what we have. So whenever we go to God in prayer, He may say, God may say to you and me, there is a problem in this area. You want me to cooperate with you, but you have disobeyed me. And if I answer your prayer, I'm condoning disobedience, meaning to say that I am giving a leeway for disobedience. I'm in a way accepting it. And God is a perfect God. Sin is sin. It has to be dealt with. God wants to answer our prayers. That's why He wants us to confess our sins and appropriate His grace, understand His grace, receive His grace. As we make a prayer, let us keep this point in mind, that in order for us to enter His presence today, our sin has to be first dealt with. This is the first point that we are learning today. Do not come with petitions, but examine your lives of sin for sin as you enter into prayer. Because this is a main thing that separates our relationship with our Heavenly Father. Father, reveal to me the sins, both subtle and glaring, that keep me from you. I want to walk in your grace and your holiness. In Jesus' name, I pray, amen. Let us ponder on this thought. Do I examine my life as I come before God in prayer? To give a quick recap of the first point of how to enter the presence of God, we need to first appropriate God's grace in our lives. And we don't come with our petitions, but examine our lives for sins. Let us do it today. Let us desire to want to come into His presence. The visible sins, we easily say we've done this, we've done that. But there are so many more subtle ones that we overlook because of ignorance and lack of knowledge, or simply we think it's not wrong. The worst of all is the spirit of unbelief. Thank you, Father. Thank you, Jesus. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
Today we will see the gospel from the Acts of Apostles, chapter 4, verses 1 to 12. Thank you, Jesus. And as they spoke unto the people, the priest and the captain of the temple and the Sadducees came upon them, being grieved that they taught the people and preached through Jesus the resurrection from the dead. Now here we see that all the people mentioned here, the priest, the captain of the temple, the Sadducees, these are all people who are religious people. And very much this is a common problem even today, where the religious spirits have created so much of disturbance and havoc in the churches that even the common person finds it difficult to keep up with their faith, to keep up with the word of God, to keep up with their belief because of the wrong teachings, the wrong religious spirits. Okay, and we see here that their main problem was that they were preaching Jesus, because they themselves could not accept Jesus as Lord God and Savior, and hence they did not like the fact that Jesus was being preached. And above all, we see that the Sadducees are a group of people who did not believe in resurrection. So the fact that these people were preaching about Christ risen was not suiting their beliefs. That's why they did not like what they were preaching. And they laid hands on them and put them in hold unto the next day, for it was now eventide. Okay, here we see that once again they have captured them for preaching Christ, and they have put them in the prison, but they did not do anything to them because it was already towards the evening time. Now we see that whenever the gospel is preached in a place where there is a lot of unbelief, where there's a lot of religious spirits, oppositions will come, persecutions will come. And we see that it's very clearly visible today. Even we notice that wherever the person has died, has become a martyr for the gospel, the conversion has been so tremendous in that place. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. However, howbeit, many of them which heard the word believed, and the number of men was about 5,000. Now we know in Romans 10:17 that faith comes from hearing God's word. And the miracle that we saw that happened in Acts 3 of the lame person walking, when Peter said, "Arise, I don't have silver or gold, but what I have I give unto you." This is the miracle that actually caught the people's attention. And when the teachings were followed after that, okay, because of which the high priest and all the Sadducees and all of them had captured them because they were preaching Christ, we see that there were so many people, and here only an account is given of the men, but we surely know that whenever there is a meeting of prayer or anything, the number of women and children is always more. Thank you, Jesus. And it came to pass on the morrow that their rulers and elders and scribes and Annas the high priest and Caiaphas and John and Alexander and as many as were of the kindred of the high priest were gathered together at Jerusalem. So we see like a kind of a repetition happening between what happened to Jesus and now what is happening to Peter. It's like everybody has gathered to decide their punishment or their fate. Okay. But it is very interesting. We will see what will happen next. And when they had set them in the midst, they asked, "By what power or by what name have you done?" Now they are not questioning if the miracle really happened, but they are interested in knowing about what is the power that has allowed them to do this. They still couldn't understand in their human understanding because they were seeing in the natural. They couldn't understand the power, the resurrection power that came when Jesus rose from the dead, because they did not believe in resurrection. They did not believe in the resurrection of the body especially. So they wanted to know. And they were very confused, like with what is the power that they are doing all these things, that they are so bold, they are so fearless, that in spite of, you know, people, the highest of the highest council members being after them, they are still not afraid. Sister, can you scroll up? Thank you, Jesus. Then Peter, filled with the Holy Ghost, said unto them, "You rulers of the people and elders of Israel." Now, very important is Peter was filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, friends, Peter being filled with the Holy Ghost is the presence of God himself. And this can only happen because he has had a relationship. We see few events before. Peter was the one to deny Jesus three times because he was filled with fear. But when the Lord appeared to him and revealed himself to them and said, "Be at peace," the forgiveness was done. The fear was lost. They were filled with the Holy Spirit. And now they were operating under the anointing. And day and night they were preaching the gospel, which means they were always in the presence of God. They were always with the Holy Spirit. And it was this very Holy Spirit, as we have said, as it is said in John 14:26, it is the Holy Spirit who will be your comforter, your advocate, your counselor. And in moments, he will tell you what you ought to do, what you have to speak. If we this day be examined of the good deed done to the impotent man, by what means he is made whole. Okay, now here we see Peter claiming it to be a good deed. A good deed. I'll read it from another translation. If we this day are judged for a good deed done to a helpless man, by what means he has been made well? So we see that Peter sees this as a good deed. So he's trying to tell them that when we have done a good deed, yet you have captured us. So how is it wrong? Then he goes on to say, be it known unto you all and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, even by him does this man stand here before you whole. And we see the courage that Peter had to acknowledge Jesus Christ of Nazareth, the same Peter who denied Jesus few events before the crucifixion. Today, he is acknowledging Christ openly. And he not only acknowledges Christ, but he tells the council members that you are the ones who have crucified him. This can only happen under the anointing of the Holy Spirit, this brave way of declaring. It cannot be done by a person in the natural. No, the person will be very scared of what the council members will do to him. What will be his fate? Praise God. This is the stone which was set at naught of you builders, which has become the head of the corner. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Okay, now here we see that they're speaking about the cornerstone. And if we see, this is a reflection of Psalms 118:22, where it was already told about a cornerstone. It says, the stone which the builders have rejected has become the chief cornerstones. Many of us today, we want Christ, but we want Christ only for getting our healings, getting our issues sorted out, maybe finances, maybe job, maybe relation problem. But we don't want the main person, Jesus. We don't want the main person with whom, if we have a relationship, eternal life is ours. Whatever we need is already been given to us in the heavenlies. We already saw that yesterday in Ephesians 1:3. We have been given everything as a free gift, but we don't want all of it. We just want the free gifts. We don't want the source. Neither is there salvation in any other, for there is none other name under heaven given among men whereby we must be saved. That's why even when we are preaching and when we are sharing, if we leave Christ out, there is no meaning to that sharing. But some of y'all will ask, then how do we preach Christ if it is a non-believer? Like from my own experience, I said, I had a desire to speak words that would edify the person, edify and speak grace to the person. So my confidence was in my Abba Father, that he will speak through me the words that need to be spoken. And it is the Holy Spirit who is my comforter in that moment, who allows me to speak to that unbelieving person. And in the due time and season, you will be allowed to speak Christ to that particular person. But you have to believe in the grace of God. As a priest, like today we learned how to enter his presence. First, we have to acknowledge the grace that he has given to us. Then only we will be able to do all of this. So today, as we intercede, we keep these key points, like how Peter went out so brave, so bold, the same Peter who denied. In the same way, we as priests who are called as a royal priesthood to step out, do not fear because God has given us every promise. The Psalms 91 that we are confessing every day, every promise of protection is there. The Holy Spirit is our comforter who goes with us. So we have to step out now in faith to preach the gospel. The stone which the builders has rejected, the cornerstone, we go and preach about him, and we preach in the name of Jesus, fearless. Thank you, Jesus. Papa? Or Sister Jocelyn, you want to add something?
Let's pray in tongues.
Okay, let's pray in tongues. Praise God. Shabala baraka shira
habala
Shalakala wala hala 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 h
Shri Krishna, Hello, Namana Muni Nyan and Nabashi Kuriyat, Hallelujah.
Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Holy Spirit. As we are going to move into worship, my dear brothers and sisters, let us very quickly run through the 23 points which are our inheritance when we declare with boldness the Psalms 91 verse 2, where you say, Lord Jesus, you are my refuge. Lord Jesus, you are my fortress. Lord Jesus, you are my God, and in you alone I trust. The 23 promises, as you can see on the screen, you make your imaginations that as we go into worship, that imagination is more deeper with the help of the Holy Spirit. You shall abide under the shadow of the Almighty. He shall deliver you from the snare of the fowler. Surely, he shall deliver you from noisome pestilence. Thank you, Jesus. He will cover you with his feathers, his truths. You shall not be afraid of the terror by night. You shall not be afraid of the arrow that flies by day. You shall not be afraid of the pestilence that walks in darkness. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. You shall not be afraid of that which destroys. You shall not be afraid of 10,000s that die around you. Especially during this time of pandemic, there is so much of fear. Let us ponder on this point and help those around us. You shall see the reward of the wickedness. There shall be no evil before you. There shall be no plague before you. Thank you, Jesus. God shall give his angels charge over you. There is complete angelic protection. You are given the power and the authority to trample down the enemy. There is a deliverance for the doers of the word. God will set you on high. God will answer you when you call to him. God will be with you when you are in trouble. God will honor you. God will satisfy you. Nothing missing, nothing broken, complete. God will show you his salvation, his anointing, and his power. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus. Let us ponder on these points while we go into worship. Make your imagination and be in the presence of God. In Jesus' name, amen. Sister, we can share the song. Just a moment. Sister, we'll stop. Praise God. Thank you, Jesus.
Sister, just wait, just a minute.
Sorry.
Yeah, no problem.